that you have people out of the country who cannot come home. They cannot come, they're stateless.
Finally, the Express is being fair and printing the truth.
We should be having trials, starting and finishing in 120 days.
What have you done to protect women and girls?
It must tell us that something is wrong.
This is Alibaba and 40 thieves in charge of Trinidad and Tobago today.
Live from the United National Congress Social Space, this is the virtual campaign. We now have the national anthem of Trinidad and Tobago, followed by a prayer. Almighty God, Creator of the universe and embodiment of divine wisdom and light, we come before you with thanksgiving and praise. May your will be done in our nation as it is in the heavens. Please bless our political leader, party officials, activists, and all the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Give us the grace to always see good, be good, and do good, and the courage to serve the people. Protect us as we stand against injustice and iniquity, and inspire our endeavors to find the right solutions to the problems that are affecting our fellow citizens. Grant that we may always work together with humility and respect for the greater happiness of all and the honor and glory of our country. Amen. Live from the United National Congress headquarters, welcome to the virtual report, streaming right now.
Tell the children the truth. Tell the children the truth. Tell the children the truth right now. Come on in.
I am not only talking about the large businesses in this country who have prospered between 2010 and 2015 when the People's Partnership Government was in power, led by the Honorable Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa.
In the image of the United National Congress, Senator Damian Lyda.
To Honorable Political Leader Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa, to my colleagues and my family of the United National Congress who are now tuned in listening to us live on social media through Facebook and through YouTube, I say to you good night at a not so good time under this PNM government. My brothers and sisters, the news of sending home 450 members of staff at Caribbean Airlines has come as the latest sad tale of this PNM government. A government which has put thousands of persons in the breadline during their tenure. And at the same time, the Prime Minister of this country comes and announces that the borders will be reopening and there will be a resumption of flights. The question stands here today. Is there a reason why you are forced to open your borders today? Tell us. We know why. We also ask you the question, what is the cost of sending home this staff today? It was the Minister of Finance who came to the Senate and indicated to the senators and to the citizens of this country that it will cost taxpayers in excess of $110 million to sever with these 450 members of staff. Yet this government is on record in the Senate stating that flights will resume to pre-COVID levels by 2023, just over a year from now. Is it that your government will be seeking to rehire those employees after they've severed with them, spending $110 million of your taxpayers' money? Will you have to rehire these employees now? Can you not have kept them employed so that they could feed their families? My brothers and sisters, if you are so confident, if this government is so confident that this vaccine rollout is a success, that you are number one in the world for COVID, and you're so positive that flights will resume at normalcy for pre-COVID levels, then why are you severing these employees today? Staff have already significantly reduced their salaries at Caribbean Airlines over the last year. What have been the expense to keep them versus the severance package required today? This will create mass employment among skilled workers such as pilots, flight attendants, ground staff, logistics, those persons that are operating in an industry with limited local options. There's no other airlines for them to work for in Trinidad. They're being placed on the chopping block. And globally, the industry is set to come back to pre-COVID levels by 2023. The government has acknowledged this. What would have been the cost to keep these workers, given that you are already taking $110 million from the public purse, your taxpayers' money, to sever from them? Brothers and sisters, you are sending workers home. Yet last October on the news headline, whilst Caribbean Airlines was busy laying people off, cutting salaries, you had a CEO of the airline paying himself a $500,000, a $500,000 bonus for performance. Where's the performance now? What is going to be the true cost of having to find staff in pre-2023 to fill these vacancies that you are now creating and then having to train employees again to get them back up to their optimal performance, to an acceptable standard? Could the government not have taken this $110 million and kept them employed till 2023? Or at least many of the critical staff that will be going home, the high-trained staff that thousands of dollars were spent on to train them. This way the country does not have to lose these qualified and trained persons who will now have to immigrate to other countries to find jobs within their own industry. And some of them who can't do that will leave the industry to find work elsewhere, never to return to industry again. They will go to find greener pastures, because there are greener pastures. Brothers and sisters, just 3 weeks ago on June the 7th, in the Business Insider published news of an explosion of hiring across the United States and the global airlines. What value do you put on the persons that have been trained 5 years, 10 years, if not more than 10 years that are now going to be put on the chopping block. Especially knowing that after this game of catch and release, you have to come and rehire them into the same positions to ensure that you have optimal staff by 2023 when the new travel bump comes. Where does the government think these trained staff will go? They are going to board the same airline that they worked for and exit this country, and we will have a brain drain in the aviation industry. Brothers and sisters, when we look at the region and we see St. Lucia during the low tourist season, getting record tourists coming in, flights coming in daily, Barbados tourism economy recovering, even Antigua has the highest bookings in hotels in the non-tourist season. Brothers and sisters, the rest of the Caribbean has been open or is reopening. Flights are coming in left, right, and center. And here we are, downsizing Caribbean Airlines. Whilst LIAT is set to liquidate and many of their routes may become vacant, we don't have the foresight to take the opportunity to pick up some of those routes that will be held vacant by LIAT dissolving. Brothers and sisters, in an article titled Major U.S. Airlines Are Going on a Hiring Spree on June 7, 2021, Business Insider outlined that though the airline industry had been hard hit by the COVID-19 pandemic, airlines are looking to fill more jobs as air travel makes a comeback. One year later, the rest of the world is recovering, and we continue to descend into the doldrums of anti-disestablishmentarianism under this PNM government. My brothers and sisters, American Airlines, Delta Airlines, United Airlines are some of those airlines that are on a hiring spree. Airlines announced that they are hiring pilots and other positions this year. In fact, full-time and part-time positions are set to be up. They rose by 6% during March. Brothers and sisters, when we look at the Association of Flight Attendants, a major airline union, they have predicted that the number of flight attendant jobs will climb from 80,000 in June to 100,000 by 2023. Brothers and sisters, when we look at jsfirm.com, an aviation job website, they revealed in an April survey that out of 200 airline companies, over half were projected moderate high growth in hiring this year. A third said they expect to hire even more in the second quarter, and we have seen that come to pass. Brothers and sisters, pilots, maintenance, avionics technicians remain in high demand today, according to that survey. And these are the quality workers that we risk losing today by this downsizing. And according to the CNN, the bookings of leisure trips are on the rise. How did we not take advantage of this for our sweet island Tobago? Brothers and sisters, it will be politically naive to think that the issue of flights from our shore will be limited only to those that will be fired from Caribbean Airlines. In fact, with the resumption of the flights going to and from Trinidad and the opening of our borders, there will be a general flight by citizens, especially our young graduates and technical professionals who are now jumping out of this country, evacuating this country, looking for better economy than under this PNM Rowley-led administration. Brothers and sisters, the latest National Insurance Board report that the Minister of Finance was pressured to bring to the Parliament showed that 113,000 less national insurance contributors have been paid since 2015 and 2020. What does that mean, brothers and sisters? In just 5 years under this PNM, one-fifth of our job seekers are now jobless, home and penniless. Brothers and sisters, these 113,000 persons will be flying out to look for a better life, provided that they could afford the plane ticket or get a visa to leave here. My brothers and sisters, Brothers and sisters, graduates from UE will be looking for their auntie in Canada, their uncle in New York, their cousin in England to go and stay by so that they can find some work outside the country. And brothers and sisters, you don't have to be a historian to remember and recall back in the 1980s when this PNM government decimated our economy, mismanaged our economy. You will remember this led to a brain drain. People headed out the country, they went foreign. A brain drain that occurred significantly in this period, brothers and sisters. But it is not only our human capital that'll be jumping out, you know, but also our financial capital as well. As many private sector businesses in this country who are now lacking confidence in our economy, and our economy shattered by this PNM government, will now be opting to invest their monies outside of the Trinidad and Tobago to our neighboring Guyana and other countries. They will opt to invest this money than invest it into our own economy, my brothers and sisters. My brothers and sisters, you stopped all the flights leaving and all the flights coming through 2020, whilst the rest of the Caribbean implemented proper protocols and opened their airports. In doing so, through your incompetence, you, the PNM government, single-handedly crashed Caribbean Airlines and put it in the state of economic failure that it is today. You cannot blame the staff of Caribbean Airlines. You can't even blame the CEO or the board. The blame falls squarely on the shoulders of every cabinet member of the People's National Movement government. My brothers and sisters, this hits close to home for me because I effectively come from a family that has its roots in the airline BWI. My grandfather, who was the general manager of maintenance. My mother, who worked for 15 years in the headquarters. My siblings and other family members who held positions as flight attendants and pilots. This hits home for me. I feel personally for those who are now about to lose their jobs today. Where this PNM is now punishing 450 loyal workers for their incompetence and their failed COVID-19 response. My brothers and sisters, while doing so, you lock thousands of our citizens out of our country who have been robbed of their constitutional rights to return to their native land. Except, of course, a small quantity of persons who fit the description of friends, family, and financiers. People lost their jobs, they lost their homes, they lost their businesses, they lost their loved ones. They weren't there to see their loved ones in the twilight of their lives close their eyes for the last time. They weren't able to send them off. They had to look at funerals via Facebook. Here we are 1 year later with COVID-19 decimating this nation, decimating our economy and taking our families. The Brazilian variant coming in through our porous borders. The Delta and Indian variant on the rise and on our doorstep. Between 9 to 20 persons dying per day and between 250 to 400 new cases every day. This is an admission of failure on your behalf. The loss of jobs and the loss of businesses falls squarely on your hands, Mr. Prime Minister. The economic decline falls squarely on your hands, the PNM. And the inability of people to see their loved ones before they die falls squarely on the entire cabinet. Brothers and sisters, opening the airport today comes from direct pressure from Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa and the United National Congress opposition. And it came from pressure from the citizens of this country. This is an admission of failure. Imagine in 2020, when the COVID cases were drastically low, when deaths were at a minimal, you shut down our borders, prevented our citizens from returning on our national carrier, where the airline lost the opportunity to minimize the losses, lost the revenue they could have gotten while locking our citizens out of the country. You come a year later where the government has lost control of this pandemic, witnessing record cases on a daily basis, countless deaths, yet you justify opening our borders now? Where's the logic in that? other than the fact that you have accepted that you have failed in your COVID-19 strategy and now pressured to reopen the borders. You create the problem and now you are forced into a solution that you have clamored for nationally, and you want us to grovel on our knees in gratitude? No, sir. The thousands of citizens in this country will never forget and never forgive you for locking them out of their nation. You take your sweet time to open the borders, yet our sea borders remain open. I have spoken at length about our porous borders, and now we see the TTPS Riverine Unit has come into action. The limited resources that you have given to Gary Griffith, who has been our only saving grace, the commissioner that you are setting up for the chopping block, don't think we don't know, starving him of resources, giving him a few small boats to patrol our borders. And while this is happening, the 6 Daemon vessels and the 1 Chinese vessel purchased by the Kamala Prasad Bisesa UNC government remain unemployed because you refuse to give the necessary resources of fuel, of spare parts, and of staff to man them. Then your failed Minister of National Security comes to this nation boasting about 2 Australian vessels that were procured without the oversight of the independent procurement regulator, will now come and solve this problem miraculously. Yet he fails to tell us if the resources will be given for fuel, for spare parts, and for the hundreds of persons necessary to man these vessels. Will these 2 Australian vessels now stand parked up in the graveyard with the rest of the Daemon vessels? Brothers and sisters, the same Minister of National Security, when he was embarrassed internationally in a virtual conference and told to wrap it up in 30 seconds, Fitzgerald Hines could have taken that 30 seconds to submit his resignation for his incompetence and lack of ability to fulfill his duties. While this minister rambles senselessly whenever given the opportunity to speak, we see foreigners flowing in and out of our country freely. Venezuelan fishing boats sail past Tetron, go up to our jetties in national fisheries and neighboring facilities, and when they arrive, no COVID testing, no quarantine, no port health officials to board to ensure that we are safe, no customs and excise, no immigration, and no documentation that states that the minister's exemption, that you've gotten a minister's exemption to come into our country. Yet you see citizens waiting for a date in July to come into our own country. These Venezuelan fishermen have more rights than citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, citizens who have been robbed of their rights and their democratic freedom. The situation was so bad that desperate Trinidadians who try to come in and out fly into Grenada and neighboring islands and then charter boats to pick them up and bring them back into Trinidad, and no one stops them. So that is the way they got back in. Brothers and sisters, as I come to a close, you give the favoritism to the Venezuelan fishermen and the illegal immigrants they smuggle, just as you give favoritism to government construction workers, which a journalist on Saturday pinpointed that it was mainly Chinese workers, and you shut him up. You shut him up. We have nothing against the Chinese workers, but you give them priority over our own locals who have been locked out of their living. Locked out construction workers, many of them living week to week, month to month, to buy food, to buy medicine, to educate their children. Yet you pull the rug out under their feet and put them in an unemployed state, grown men and women watching their children cry because of their inability to sustain them. Brothers and sisters, they sat on Saturday at your 2:30 circus show, hoping to see the chief clown finally put an end to this charade and announce that His Highness will allow construction workers to get back out. Yet you crush their hearts, you crush their souls, but effectively showing them that foreigners have more rights than them. My brothers and sisters, this government has taken advantage of the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. When a brother of a minister can get billions of dollars in financial contracts, that is advantage. When families and friends can get rental contracts, when citizens suffer and are sent home, that is advantage. when government changes laws to benefit themselves in real estate. That is advantage. My brothers and sisters, as long as we have to endure under this PNM, citizens of Trinidad and Tobago will know that advantage never done. Brothers and sisters, enough is enough. It is time to end this PNM pressure. They must call an elections forthwith, and they must give the citizens of this country an opportunity to right the wrongs, to protect them, to protect their country. Those who you have betrayed, who marched left foot, right foot, and signed their name with a golden pen, you must give them now an opportunity to finally put a government that cares, a government that works, and a government that will deliver, led by Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa and our very capable team at the United National Congress. I thank you, brothers and sisters.
The new qualification process for social services at the Ministry of Social Development is hurting the vulnerable and putting them in worst off positions. Imagine disabled people who are wheelchair bound are being denied.
From our national headquarters and virtual space, the Member of Parliament for Shogunas East, Vandana Mohit.
Honorable political leader, Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa, and you, our viewers, a very pleasant good evening. Let me begin this evening by saying, Trinidad and Tobago, we cannot get worse than we are. When our citizens are treated with no respect, when citizens have to rush to get a spot in a line for food, when citizens have to rush to find money and line up to pay WASA, we are in a very bad place as a nation. We have a prime minister who spills garbage each and every time he speaks, and his ministers will follow suit. Friends all, let us have a look this evening at the Minister of Social Development and Family Services, Donna Cox. And I am sure many of you are familiar with this front page and with this article, Needy or Greedy. Friends, as we go on to have a look at Minister Donna Cox, the best she could have done for the people who are suffering out of their minds during these tough times is call them greedy and say to them that it is not that bad out there or out here. Ladies and gentlemen, her statements were made referencing to these long lines, as you can see, in South Park last Friday. But we have to ask Minister Cox whether she's a psychic, whether she's better than Imbert, who said he isn't a psychic. We have to also ask Minister Donna Cox. Minister Donna Cox looked at a line and knows that persons in that line were recipients of income support. They were recipients of NAMDEVCO hampers, and they were recipients of $250 food cards. She just looked at that line and formed that conclusion. How foolish, how callous, how inhumane, Minister Donna Cox. Minister Donna Cox went on. This morning, we saw two articles reported in the Daily newspaper, where Cox defends greedy comment and outcry. Social Development and Family Services Minister says words taken out of context. Where Minister Cox also said, resign for what? Resign for what? Why should she resign?
Minister Donna Cox is asking why she should resign? Minister, you should resign because you have no heart for the people you serve. You are out of touch with reality. Imagine you are saying the situation is not that bad. And imagine Minister Cox has the audacity. This article where the minister is asking resign for what? The minister has the audacity to say it is clear that the UNC had nothing to speak about today, which was yesterday, or no release to send out, so they found something that they can now try to spin a story on. Minister Donna Cox, for your information, it is not only the UNC who saw your statement as callous, as foolish, as inhumane, a statement which lacks no compassion. It is the entire country of Trinidad and Tobago condemning your statement that our citizens who are in need of food at this time are greedy. We have to ask her again, Minister Cox, where have you been? Where have you been residing? This minister went on to say that the ministry is distributing sums of $1,500, which is to buy food. Can you believe that? The Ministry of Social Development is distributing sums of $1,500, which is to buy food. Is this how Minister Cox is running her ministry? Is this how you take into account the needs of a household? So what happened to rent, bills, etc.? Let me give you the reality, Minister Cox. And the reality is, a market box can only do so much. I would like for you to go with a $250 food card to the supermarket and tell me what will you, Minister Donna Cox, get. I would like for you, Minister Donna Cox, to try budgeting $1,500 in your house for 1 month. And tell me if we wouldn't see you, Donna Cox, outside South Park, lining up for a hamper. Are you the same woman, the same minister, who had no voice for the construction sector just recently? Are you the same minister who forgot about them, leaving them without anything during this lockdown period? Trinidad and Tobago, I am reminding you that this government cares about no one. Can you understand, citizens, can you understand why would the government of Trinidad and Tobago open the government construction sector and leave the private construction sector closed? Can you understand the logic behind that? Is it that COVID can spread from the private sector construction? Is it that COVID can spread only from the private construction sector? You really have to ask, what are they thinking when they are making these decisions? Can we also understand why would the construction sector be facilitated by the government in terms of the relief support for the month of June and not the month of May? So what happened to these people in the month of May? The Minister of Finance announced, as well as the Prime Minister, that the construction sector would be facilitated in terms of the relief grants for the month of June. So what happened to these people in the month of May? How are they supposed to live in the month of May? Citizens, this is the same minister who had no voice for this sector. And we are asking her, Donna Cox, where is your voice for the people you claim to be representing? Is it that members of the construction sector would be too greedy to want support for the month of May? Tell us the logic behind the government's thinking and decision making. Ladies and gentlemen, friends all, Donna Cox also went on to say in this article, resign for what? She went on to say that the UNC now wants to pretend that they care and the government doesn't care. Since when? She's even saying they are very much aware, and I have the records to show that I have been accounting to the population about what we have been doing. You've heard that statement. I am now going on to tell you. Minister Donna Cox says she has records for what she has been doing. But yet still, Minister Donna Cox is running and hiding from answering very important questions as it relates to the vulnerable society in Trinidad and Tobago who are depending on the Social Development Ministry. She's running and hiding from answering and accounting for $330 million allocated to the Ministry of Social Development and Family Services. Minister Cox came to the mid-year review. She came in the mid-year review to justify an additional $40 million to be used for the payments of income support effective May 1st, 2021. Yet, she could not account for the original sum of $330 million. Citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, do you remember the recent motion of no confidence in the Minister of Finance, Colum Imbert? Do you remember Minister Donna Cox's presentation where she thanked the Minister of Finance for all that he did for citizens in terms of COVID relief support? She came to the Parliament and she declared full confidence in the Minister of Finance and never said that persons who were approved for income support grant, persons who were approved for rental grant, etc., still to date have not been paid. In other words, she did not say and mention at all that there were outstanding COVID support grants from the Ministry of Social Development and Family Services. But she came to declare her full confidence in Minister Imbert. Now, Minister Donna Cox, she's running from answering this. So today we are asking Donna Cox, as we have done before on many occasions publicly, and we are asking the Minister of Finance as well, when will you finalize the releases to pay the outstanding approved income support and rental grants from 2020. I have with me, and every time I see it, I take a record of it. And I read for you a comment on the official website of the Ministry of Social Development and Family Services where a citizen says, and yet still, it have people waiting from since last year. And the ministry responds, Ministry of Social Development and Family Services, as soon as the funds are released to us, the approved clients will be paid. The approved clients will be paid. So which confirms by the Ministry of Social Development and Family Services that there are outstanding payments for the income support and the rental grants from since 2020. So where did the $330 million in allocation for this fiscal year go that Minister Cox she requested in the mid-year review an additional $40 million for COVID support? What is going to happen to these outstanding grants? When will these people be paid? And you are here today saying to them they are greedy to line up for food. Friends, it is heart-wrenching to see these people are begging still. And Minister Donna Cox has the gall and the belly to stand and say, the situation is not bad out here. And worst of all, to stand this morning, as you can see reported, and say that she stands by her statement and resign for what? We are saying to you, you need to resign. You are not wanted because you have no compassion for our citizens of Trinidad and Tobago who are in dire need at this time. Trinidad and Tobago, they have been running from giving you the facts. Sometimes you really have to sit and wonder if we have a cabinet who meet. Are you telling us, Minister Cox, and the entire government of Trinidad and Tobago, are you telling us that the situation is not bad out here when WASA has to announce a debt collection drive? Did Danakok see those lines? But yet she's saying the situation is not bad and people are being greedy? My people of Trinidad and Tobago, I am saying to you as a young representative, do not sit for 1 minute and be fooled that the PNM has a care for you, the people of this country. They care nothing about you. They care about themselves. Friends, we have with us some recommendations. The situation, we are telling Minister Donna Cox, the situation is bad out here. The minister said she's everywhere. We are yet to see her in many parts of Trinidad and Tobago. And based on the minister's statement, and based on the behavior of this government of Trinidad and Tobago, and based on the suffering that we are seeing each and every day, we stand by our recommendations because we cannot sit and look at the people of this country suffer. We are calling on the Ministry of Social Development. This is providing Minister Donna Cox is not fired, revoked, or take the initiative to really do the honorable thing and resign and we get a new minister. But we are calling on the ministry's work has to go on. We are calling on the Ministry of Social Development to announce and engage in immediate consultation with key stakeholders such as private companies and charitable organizations who are initiating hamper drives to ensure the compliance with the public health regulations so that as much help can be generated towards the vulnerable during these tough times. Madam Minister, it is your job to embrace persons and not call them greedy. Get yourself into reality and work. As we have seen, charitable organizations have a message for Donna Cox. You are under fire. The entire country is against you. We do not see our citizens as greedy. These are organizations who are working with the communities every day, day into night, helping the needy. Get yourself into reality and host consultations to see how best we can work with these charitable organizations to get assistance as much as we can for the needy. We are calling on the Minister of Finance to act on the extra funding in which he announced during the mid-year review, which is to be directed into the provision of additional food cards and provide more than $250 in each food card. Persons are in need of dry goods as well, and it is more than needed at this time. We are also calling on the Minister of Finance and the Minister of Social Development to extend the relief support for the construction sector for the month of May as well. Do not allow citizens to go into a further state of desperation. And lastly, we are calling on the government to begin the distribution of salary relief grants and income support grants for the month of May. Do not allow a repeat of 2020. Citizens who are in need can never be greedy. People will not rush for help if they really don't need the help. Minister Donna Cox, if you cannot see, I will lend you my glasses. Citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, I urge you, be safe, keep the faith. God bless our nation. God bless our political leader, the Honorable Kamala Prasad Bisesa. I thank you.
In any civilized and modernized society, you have what is called an independent oversight machinery looking and examining and scrutinizing the awards of contracts.
Pre-recorded at a virtual space, Senator Wade Mark.
Honorable Kamala Prasad, Misesa, political leader of our great and glorious party, my fellow speakers preceding me and emerging after me, my brothers and sisters all, this evening we would like to spend a few moments on the clear and present danger posed by a criminal enterprise with clearly defined mafia-type features, parading and masquerading as a political party of the poor and the grassroots. This party is the People's National Movement. It is now known as the Brotherhood of Wrongdoers. It represents the interests and agenda of the rich, the mighty, and the powerful. The PNM is literally pauperizing and oppressing the working class and transforming them into literally hewers of wood and drawers of water. This criminal enterprise has capsized their founding father principle, which when he enunciated a state-led development model of development and has reduced it to a privately led free enterprise, laissez-faire driven development model in which the state sector is being systematically dismantled and it's remained completely privatized and placed into the hands of a tiny, powerful minority, all at the expense of the majority of our people. What is the current reality in Trinidad and Tobago? Brothers and sisters, let us examine briefly four issues to demonstrate the strategy of this criminal mafia enterprise designed to make the rich richer and the poor poorer. Firstly, the speed in its decision to privatize the port of Spain with some 1,500 to 1,800 workers being earmarked for dismissal. All of those workers are from Port of Spain, Betum, John, Sealots, Diego Martin, Carinage, and its environs. The proposed TNT rate increase and its impact on the working class. The massive $2.1 billion in losses recorded and announced recently by the NGC. Who is responsible and why? And the continued PetroTrain saga involving a new RFP, request for proposal, and the recent arbitration award, which if not set aside by the High Court, could cost the people, the taxpayers, over $1 billion. Who is mining the store? Who is looking after the people's interests in this dangerous and disturbing matter? Let us look at the privatization of the port. The goal of this criminal enterprise, masquerading as a political party, is to make the Port Authority a landlord and in the process fire and dismiss close to 1,800 port workers, both monthly and daily rated. This is the aim
of this government as they seek to wipe out the SWWTU and by extension dismantle the Trinidad and Tobago Modern Trade Union movement. There has been no consultation whatsoever with the workers' representatives, that is the SWWTU. There is a subsisting collective agreement for the period 2014 to 2017, which its criminal administration has failed to honor. This involves a 12% increase in salary. What will happen to the workers' severance pay, as well as their pension benefit, if this brotherhood of wrongdoers pursue their privatization and retrenchment policy at the port? Is it because the collective agreement, brothers and sisters, was signed by the PP administration? Why is the government, this kleptocratic government, not honoring this agreement? Then there is the bizarre and absurd decision to allow NITCO to procure and manage, as well as maintain, the two fast ferries, the APT James and the Buko Reef. And this is being done, the management of this, these two ferries, and the actual sailing of these two ferries are being undertaken by complete foreign outfit. And this crew, as well as the maintenance, is costing us roughly $160 million. Is it that the government led by Dr. Rowley hate the workers of this country so much that they have no more foreigners to replace our local workers? These two vessels cost the taxpayers over $1 billion. If the government is about to privatize the port, in the absence of a public procurement and public disposal of property act, as was initially advanced in 2015, why did the government invest close to $100 million in the recent purchase of a modern crane? Brothers and sisters, the port owns extremely rich and powerful real estate running from the Mount of Woodbrook right up to Bhagwan Singh, brothers and sisters. Who is eyeing this? Is it the Chinese? Is it the local conglomerate? Why is this criminal enterprise seeking, brothers and sisters, to recolonize our nation in 2021? We know that the Chinese are already in charge of a port in Jamaica. Is the government seeking to give the Chinese our port in Trinidad and Tobago? These are questions that we need to ask. And what about the port in Tobago? Who is going to be given that port? Is it a good friend of the Prime Minister? A powerful businessman who just sold to the THA lands worth millions of dollars to build a secondary school? Does that man, who is a close associate of the Prime Minister, has an interest in the port? We want the Prime Minister to answer this question. Brothers and sisters, we are totally opposed to the privatization of the port of Trinidad and Tobago. And we call on this criminal PNM government to cease and desist from this reckless and irresponsible course of action. We are also completely opposed to any rate increase in electricity supply for the people of this country. Even the Regulated Industries Commission, whilst they are contemplating such action, we call on that body and the government to take account of the following. One, why is the government owing TNTech over $1.2 billion today? The government, its states and its state entities, its ministries, its statutory authorities are owing TNTech over $1.2 billion today. Pay your bill, You don't have to increase electricity rates if you pay your bill. The other thing that is causing TNTech a lot of worries is that in 1993, the government of this country entered into an arrangement with PowerGen for TNTech to buy gas at its expense to supply to PowerGen and then take electricity generated by PowerGen and pay for it. That is crippling TNTech. That is a matter that has to be revisited. And then what about the removal of the subsidies, the subsidy on gas? This is a matter that the citizens are very concerned about. Then we go to the NGC, the National Gas Company. This was the flagship company of Trinidad and Tobago. However, it has published results of its 2020 financial audited statements revealing that it lost or it experienced a loss of some $2.1 billion. Why did the NGC end up in this way? Why this financial conundrum? We put the blame squarely at the feet of this criminal enterprise led by this government. This government is responsible for the state of affairs at NGC. And I'll tell you why. Brothers and sisters, the government and the chairman of NGC must explain why it invested over $300 million of taxpayers' money into Train 1 when they knew that Train 1 has crashed. No gas going to Train 1 because there's a shortfall in gas supply in Trinidad and Tobago, hence the collapse of the Point Lisa's estate. So the government pumped over $300 million into Train 1. That is one of the reasons why NGC is now reporting a $2.1 billion loss, my brothers and sisters. Then the other area that we have to pay attention to that has caused the NGC to make this huge loss in 2020 has to do with the decision of the Prime Minister, the former Minister of Energy, and the current Minister of Energy to negotiate new natural gas prices with EOG, Shell, and BPTT in Houston, Texas in 2017, brothers and sisters. That decision has resulted in a pricing formula that is disadvantageous to the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Brothers and sisters, this ban of political hooligans and almost national traitors negotiated a price which was 20% higher than the price that the downstreamers plan pay or can pay for gas. This deal has resulted in a loss to NGC amounting to over $1.5 billion on an annual basis. Brothers and sisters, hear what this criminal enterprise did in Houston, Texas. They negotiated with the upstreamers. The upstreamers, EOG, BPTT, and Shell, were asking for $3.25 US per MMBTU. The NGC was willing to negotiate and sign off a deal at $3.10 US cents per MMBTU. You know what this criminal enterprise agreed to? They agreed, brothers and sisters, to a cost of a price rather of $3.50 US per MMBTU. This, brothers and sisters, is largely responsible for the crisis that this company is now experiencing today. We do not know if this is Act 1, Scene 2. They have already crashed the company called Petrotrin, and they are now doing a business with Petrotrin demise. We want to know if the same fate now awaits the National Gas Company. Is it a replay of the collapse and the dismantling of the Petrotrin that is now being replayed at NGC. Brothers and sisters, the government, the chairman of NGC, they have to answer questions. Why did they go the route that they have gone? Why did you invest $300 million and after 1 year or close to 10 months to a year, that company is not in operation? So that is something that we need to deal with. And brothers and sisters, the Petrotrin saga continues. It is Project Calypso. It is our considered view that the fake oil scandal led to the closure and destruction of Petrotrin and the dismissal of 10,000 workers and the destruction of scores of small businesses in the South. The attempt to fool the people and the OWTU into believing that they can buy the Pointe Pierre refinery has now been fully revealed and exposed. The OWTU on three occasions was rejected. On three occasions, that company called Patriotic Energies and Technologies Company Limited, their proposals were rejected. They have a fourth one that is submitted in March 2021. That too will be rejected. We want to ask the following questions. The government has sold out the workers of this country. We want to know the following. What is the role of Scotia Capital in the latest RFP? Was Scotia Capital involved in the 2019 US $570 million at 9.75% senior secured notes due in 2026? How was Scotia Bank or Scotia Capital selected? Did not the father of the energy minister, the current energy minister, served as the managing director of Scotia Bank of Trinidad and Tobago for several years? Isn't the father of the energy minister not the chairman of the International Finance Corporation Limited? Is the minister conflicted by this reality? And if so, let him come out and recuse himself and indicate to the country. Brothers and sisters, is it a fact that the international financial institutions have stated that they would not be lending monies to owners and giants in the energy sector if they continue to invest in fossil fuel in the future, and therefore renewables is the way to go? These are matters that we have to deal with. And therefore, this new request for proposal is a mama guy once again that the government is perpetuating and fooling the country. Brothers and sisters, it is clear that the government has dismantled the people's energy giant, Petrotrin, for its own selfish political ends and is now playing games in taking action to set aside the arbitration awards at the involving ANV Oil and Gas Limited. If this government, through its board of directors, failed to take action to appeal this unjust arbitration award and breach its fiduciary duty to the citizens of this country, all shall be culpable, responsible, and liable for abuse of office and misfeasance and misconduct in public office. The public and the people are watching, and they are paying close attention to the shenanigans of the current chairman of the board of directors of Trinidad Petroleum Holdings Limited in this significant matter. The people will have their say no matter what. We call on the Keith Rowley administration to do the right thing and appeal that unjust arbitration award, which in the final analysis, if not set aside, could cost the people and the taxpayers hundreds of millions of dollars. Long live the United National Congress. Long live the Honorable Kamala Prasad Bisesa. Long live our working class. Long live the struggle for equality, peace, justice, and freedom in Trinidad and Tobago. Forward ever, backward never. Forward ever, backward never. Forward ever, backward never. Thank you very much, my brothers and sisters.
Trinidad and Tobago, we are in trouble. And unless we rebel against the wine press, we will continue to be trodden in circles. So my people, while I commend each and every one of you.
Pre-recorded at our virtual space, Senator Anil Roberts.
Good evening. I start in one time a question to the worst attorney general in the history of Trinidad and Tobago. Faris a la rental, a la rawi, a la tight pants, a la tight shirt, a la jump in a room without a mask to jump and whine and dribble on 13 man in one room. You, Mr. Man, what is the position with the fake oil appeal? I see that Deborah Peak has senior counsel has requested an appeal be lodged and be filed by PetroTrin in the fake oil arbitration. Has that appeal been filed? Everybody studying all kind of thing, all kind of situation. The failure of the COVID fight. Convent girl talking with more convent accent in the parliament, talking nonsense. Rowley accusing Kamala, all kind of thing, making up and creating confusion. The media letting it slide, but not here on the UNC virtual. Faris a la Rawi, a la recusal, a la tight shot. What and where, what is the position of the appeal as recommended highly and strongly by senior counsel Deborah Peak into the fake oil arbitration? You know, because you say to ask Kamala. So when I on our UNC virtual and you say ask Kamala, I say ask tight shot. Tight shot, on December 23rd, 2017, you made it clear that you are investigating yourself. The PNM is investigating the PNM. The PNM is anti-corruption. The PNM is in charge of the PNM board. The PNM and the PM and the PM friend being investigated by a PNM PetroTrin board that was removed and another one that was put in its place. You said the PNM is showing the country the way forward to be anti-corruption and for transparency and accountability. It is the PNM that is investigating the PNM in the PetroTrin fake oil standard that a PNM board asked for an audit and the PNM board terminated the friend of the PM Prime Minister, PNM PM Prime Minister. You see how many P's it is? Well, let's keep you on your P's and Q's, Faris Al-Rawi, Al-Rental, Al-Recusal, Al-One-Shot. What is the status of the appeal in that matter? Because you know, the PNM and you as Attorney General and Smallpin, when he was in your office, you all have a track record of pulling PNM out of court. You pull out Malcolm Jones and you still pay Stuart Smallpin Young his legal fees because that was Malcolm Jones' lawyer. You didn't care about the $3 billion that was wasted by an executive chairman of PetroTrin under the PNM. The Privy Council ridicule you, Al-Rawi. You'll go down in history as a Commonwealth Attorney General ridiculed by the Council of the Privy. You understand? You are not just a local goat. You are an international goat. Meh. Right? And you also pull out Ken Julian Bamboo Networks. After Christine Sahadeo, a former PNM minister in the Ministry of Finance, wrote Ken Julian and said, do not invest in Bamboo Networks. $31 million of taxpayer money went. He ignored the advice of the minister in the Ministry of Finance, written, he take people money and invest it and the money gone. Y'all, the case gone too. What about the helicopter case? Did you do your best there, Al-Rawi? Did you really fight that case? You leave a helicopter that was purchased and leased by the Kamala Prasad Bisesa government to keep Trinidad and Tobago border safe. You left it parked up somewhere in a warehouse. Did you fight that case? What's the position with that case? What are the new arguments? Please advise the country. We could walk and chew gum at the same time. Donna. Oh, Donna, my people greedy, eh, Donna? My people who are hungry and starving, who have not worked for 16 months, who are on perpetual lockdown because of the incompetence of your government, who before COVID were at the highest unemployment rate in the history of Trinidad and Tobago, shutdown of Petrotrin, shutdown and cutting of jobs across the public sector, shutdown of NESC, MIC centers, IT workers at the Ministry of Education, NEDCO, across the board. No jobs created, no foreign direct investment before COVID. During COVID, total complete lockdown, shutdown and brockdown. Now we on lockdown for the last 54 days. We in state of emergency for over 40 days. People have not worked. Daily paid workers cannot work. Before COVID, 23.8% of the population were below the poverty rate. Now that could be up at 32%. 32% of 1,010,000 adults local. That is approximately 323,000 people that are below the poverty rate, that have not worked, people who had no savings. And you telling me, my people who going for a hamper, they greedy? Did you do an investigation? Express, you put in a poll to ask people if you agree with Donna Cox that people who in a line in hot sun lining up for a $300, $400 hamper, to ask people their general opinion without information on whether they agree with Donna Cox that is greedy people in a line going for food? What was in that hamper that's so important? What, flour, rice, corned beef, sardine, a piece of chicken? What it was? $300, $400? And you all have the audacity, Express, without investigation. Express, you should have sent reporters down in the line to investigate, to see the people, to let the country know what is the real situation out there. You should have been interviewing people in the line, those who were willing to, because plenty of people were shame and hiding their face. You come to ask people a poll, and people on the internet who have savings, who have grocery, who have freezer, saying 54% agree that the hungry, starving citizens who lining up in the hot sun for a hamper, that they are greedy. And Express, you call that journalism? Did you go and check the people? Did you go and investigate? Did you go in their house and check the fridge and see if they have a fridge? See if they have a cupboard? See if the cupboard have food? See how many children there? See how many people were down there? What kind of work they were doing? You do no investigative journalism, but you're playing politics, Express. How disgusting when people are hungry to try and make the most inhumane, insensitive statement ever made by a sitting minister. Donna Cox moved from nobody into number one position of lack of heart. Donna, oh Donna. And you're saying, but what to apologize for, Donna? You're doubling down like Rowley. You're doubling down like when you and Rowley. Anyway, let me not talk that now on the virtual, right? But Donna, you know what I'm talking about. But when you're lying and you hug up a heartless, you sometimes you become heartless, eh, Donna? And it looks like you're really heartless. You say your statement was taken out of context. What context could poor people who cannot work because of your cabinet decision, because of your government, because the whole place on lockdown, shutdown, and broke down? In what context could calling those people greedy make sense? What context, Donna? Anyway, you eat cake and chase it down with almond milk, you and Shamfa. But you see, Donna Cox's statement is nothing new. It follows the trend and the policy of Keith Christopher Rowley. It is not a new statement. That is the way the PNM cabinet under Rowley views you, the citizens. Rowley's overarching principle of the new society is for you, the people, starting with the most vulnerable, to wean yourself off the government. He said, well, everything has been the government, the government, the government. Well, his government cannot afford to do that. So you had better wean yourself off the government. And some poor people in the PNM clapping that man saying that. But he taking your money to go and sign contract, to buy ferry without procurement, to give HEC contract to Chinese company and pay them upfront money. He taking your money to go and buy painting, to go and fix golf course, to go and build airport, to go and let government construction start while private sector shut down. And all you're clapping that, he weaning you off of your own taxpayer dollars. He putting VAT back on and taxing you. And y'all PNM people clapping that. He taking laptop up your children's mouth. And y'all clap that. But that's the policy. And don't get confused. Donna's heartless statement trickles through. We can go and we can talk. Remember Ethelbert. Where is Ethelbert? Ethelbert, you pumpsite rasta, where are you? The borders are porous. The crime is out of hand. We have no security. The Coast Guard park up. Have you gotten diesel for them to bounce the starter? What about the radar? A boat are dead floating to our borders. People getting robbed and pirates during a pandemic and lockdown. Where are you at, Talbot? Are you still telling people to break the law if they find gun in the house? Throw it out in the road and the bush and don't tell the police who own it is? You're still out there advising people to break the law, Ethelbert. But remember what Ethelbert had said. When the young black people in this country were protesting, Ethelbert said they are lazy. They don't want to sweat, but they want to go to heaven. Remember that? That was Ethelbert talking about his own constituents. And then election call and my people, he gave about 10,000 votes. But that is the thought process, that young black people don't want to work hard. They don't want to sweat. That is the PNM way. And they are here to wean you off the government. It wasn't just Ethelbert. When small pin Stuart Young was the Minister of National Security and young black people across this country saw a video where police appeared to be misbehaving, where three men in a car were shot all over the place, and man, policeman seen picking up thing off the ground, pick up the three men like it's a agouti and pelt them in a van and bust out. When young black people saw that, they started simultaneously across the country to protest because they saw that that was wrong. That was an infringement on their rights. That was not proper police procedure, and something was wrong. Stuart Smallpin Young called a press conference to say, is UNC paying young black people to protest? Do you remember that? Insulting the intelligence of young black people, saying that them not bright enough to understand when they see a video that that wrong. So them don't know what is wrong. Them had to be told what is wrong by the UNC and paid. That is a disrespectful, disgusting statement, but it follows the heartless policy of Rowley. When you hear Camille Robinson-Regis, when she was minister, not minister of handbag and wig and cash going in and out and so on. When we are talking about the pandemic and people were complaining that they're not seeing the grants, they're not getting the grants, they can't get it, and months passing, Camille Robinson-Regis went and said, we have seen some fraud. People are filling out their forms and they are not putting the truth. They are signing a declaration and she going to send police for them. But Camille, the police here check you yet? What about your declaration that you signed on the 143,000 cash that you take out, but you didn't take out, but you put back, but it wasn't there? What about that? Oh, but you all forget the principle of the PNM, that people come in for hamper and small grant and little pittance that cannot even take care of one person, far less for a family of four. When they are locked down, broke down, and shut down for 16 months, they can't even get 3 months of $1,500, and then some people was getting less. They say it's fraud after fraud. But that's the policy of the PNM. We remember the Dwayne telling you about double dipping, because there's double dipping and this is slowing down the process because he wants to make sure that poor people don't double dip in at $1,500. But he double dip all over. He double dipping down the islands by his house. Well, I see he stopped the construction now during the pandemic. But when he double dip and the PNM double dip and he and his boys recuse themselves 92 times and one attorney general renting his own building, and not only the rental was good, he double dip and take a $38 million to outfit his own building. And then a next one double dip and recuse himself 37 times. Two of them recuse themselves 92 times from the cabinet because they dipping and scooping. That is not double dipping. Them not greedy. My people who want a little rice and flour to make bread, a little crisps and cheese, a little sardine, a little pilori, a little roti, a little tomato choker. Them greedy. Shamfa Kujo, you forget? Shamfa Kujo telling the whole pro league, all you wean yourself off the government. Why must the government support you? Y'all are professional. Make money. Nonsense. The Pro League provides jobs, provides opportunities for young people, especially young black boys. It don't have much Indian playing football. The last Indian I know is Danu Lal from Caledonia AIA. It's young black boys in this country, and you want to play race and say that PNM is the black people party. But Rowley want to give all your banana. Remember Glenda Jennings-Smith up in Grandy talking about only giving hamper to PNM people. Remember when Coburn was the Minister of Social Development after Glenn Ramadasinghe had increased food cards from 18,000 up to 42,000. when the poverty rate was only 16.8%, but Glenn Ramadasin increased that food cuts of 42,000. The PNM came and say that plenty people have food cards who shouldn't have, and take away 24,000 food cards before pandemic. Remember that? That's their policy. And when they did that and they went down to 18,000 food cards, when it should have been going up to 160,000, because 16.7% of 1 million is 167,000. So you should have been increasing the number of food cards to make sure our citizens can eat. The PNM cut it, and their rationale was, all your double dipping, people who shouldn't have it, have it. And that is their policy. Remember the exemption policy that started during the pandemic, that right now they're boasting July 16th, July 17th, borders going to open, but borders open and yesterday 17 people dead. We had 817 people dead. We are Brazilian variant, but borders was closed when them tell we had no COVID, no community spread for 54 days last year between April, March 22nd and June. No cases, no community spread, 116 positive, nobody in the hospital, but borders was closed and people were oppressed. But some could come and go. Al-Rawi children could come and go. Al-Rawi's son could go for 2 months and come back. The shortest semester in the history of education. People could go, Shampa could go and shop and come back. That's how it was, because y'all greedy and y'all double dipping. But that's the system of the PNM. They believe that is one law for them and one for the rest of you. And when you see the borders are coming to open while we are under total pressure, highest death rate in the world per million, why it opening? How it opening? What's the science? That is an abject total confession by Keith Christopher Rowley. That is exemption policy of 17 months to oppress the constitutional right, the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, was wrong at the beginning, it was wrong in the middle, and it is wrong at the end, that it did not work, and you oppress citizens for no reason. To call an election with 30,000 citizens outside and win an election by a so-called 18,000 margin, with an EBC official, a relative of the niece of a former sitting minister and best friend of the current minister of bundles, who every week it are bundles and bundles, but SEA coming Thursday, they telling teachers to go and get vaccinated Saturday. But when you get vaccinated, it takes 3 weeks for the antibodies to be produced. So the mama guy teachers putting them at risk, and all of our people are dying. Remember when they tell us, take whatever vaccine they, no choice for all you. I thought, I checked to see if we in Russia, China, Venezuela, Cuba, or somewhere, I thought we turned communist. Remember when they were saying that? Take what you get. You have to take what you get. Wean yourself of the government. No choice for you. But somebody bring the Pfizer. Who let the Pfizer pass? Rowley, did you take the Pfizer? When could the member for Cuba ask you? Where the Pfizer? Did you take the Pfizer? You sat a ball. Kamala have COVID. Kamala no COVID. And who are you to come and in the parliament and lie once again? You think the parliament is your little playhouse for your dishonest, ridiculous notions? And if Kamala had COVID, how you know? Who tell you? You're invading the health, the patient privacy. Who told you? The doctors? Who? Convent girl? Anyway, we moving right along. We greedy. The people of Trinidad and Tobago are greedy. Eh? You don't want to know what they're doing? Rowley has said that we are greedy. Donna Cox say we greedy. Ethelbert say we greedy. Smallpin, Camille say we greedy. All the PNM ministers say we greedy. So you know what they are doing? Their mission has been and continues to be to wean you off of Kamala. Because Kamala may call you greedy. So they want to wean you off of Kamala. That's why they're calling Kamala, Kamala, Kamala name. Like it's sticking the throat. Because Kamala feed your greed. So they say your greed. Because Kamala give your children's life fund, school feeding program, gate, laptops, food cards, differently able grant, baby milk, sport and football, pan funding, culture. The PNM find that is greedy. Kamala should not have given you all that. Kamala should not have used your money to give you the resources and your children the opportunity to survive and thrive. So the PNM policy under Rowley is to wean all you off Kamala. Kamala give you textbooks, leave the gas subsidy, water for 72%, 24/7 supply, no VAT on food, 7,000 items, no new taxes. Now, them want to take Kamala electricity subsidy and all and triple your electricity rates. That's the policy of the PNM. They take away Kamala procurement legislation to try and prevent corruption so that them could do what they want and procure. Rowley come to wean the people off of Kamala. How you are as a father or a mother, remember that, will determine how you will rule as a leader. Being a father or a mother is very important. Rowley does tell you outside children, no food, no clothes, no laptop, no car, no transport, no pocket money for all your outside children. Don't be greedy, Gat Allen, you Tobagonian outside child. Don't be greedy to want these things. But my inside children, they are not greedy. They are needy. That's what Rowley does say. What 10-year-old Gat Allen, what he wanted when he asked his father, I want a new little tango football, when he was 10. And Rowley tell him, boy, don't be greedy. And he look at the inside children later on and he say, hey, baby girl, my nice inside child. Hey, baby, look, daddy. Look, daddy buy house, daddy buy land, but daddy buy multi-dwelling building, shares in NCB, merchant bank, two ferry, houses, airport, golf course, painting, all for you, my inside child. Hey, got you outside, don't worry, no football for you. We, the people, we is Rowley outside children. That's how he treating me. Anyway, anybody have a forklift for me to drive down by Balize house? That's what I want. So I done there. But here now, there are no Madam President here. So I'm going and take an extra 2 minutes here today because I want you all to understand that Kamala Prasad Bisesa, if she was Prime Minister, and a good coach has always walk with the stopwatch. I see Fennec with one of these. Kamala Prasad Bisesa, if she was Prime Minister, the COVID-19 pandemic fight would have been different. Life in Trinidad and Tobago would have been different. Ready? Let me tell you why. Go! Because Kamala Prasad Bisesa had real doctors in her cabinet and MPs. She would have had the advice. She would have had the full debate and created a program. She'd have ensured that there was enough testing across the board so that we could have been testing all during Carnival and make sure there was contact tracing to either have a safe Carnival or cancel it based on the data. She would have ensured that the borders would have remained open for citizens to be repatriated under PAHO and World Health Organization, while the borders, official borders, would have been closed to internationals so that we would have kept our islands pristine. She would have ensured that the porous borders were locked. The Coast Guard would have had diesel. The helicopters, Air Guard would have been flying. The Army would have been from Fullerton to Ikakas with jeeps and full floodlights. The police would have been out in roadblocks to lock down the place. Officials in Carnage and Chagramas, they would have stopped the Venezuelan fishermen from coming in with unchecked. There would have been health officials out there, customs and excise. The borders would have been sealed with a security dome. Then she would have ensured that the economy would have been moving. She would not have shut down beaches and rivers and outdoor activities. She would have ensured agriculture continues and that local products would have been sold. She would have ensured that we in Trinidad and Tobago would have kept the economy going so that jobs would have been able to continue. This, the money that she would have been given at grants would not have been 1,500. It would have been more realistic up at 3,000. She would have created a system of public servants in warehouses to keep printing checks so that everybody, 200,000 people, because more people would have applied, because the forms would not have been so arduous. She would have printed out those checks and made sure that they were printed within 3 to 4 weeks. Everybody would have had their money. There would have been better management of the hospitals. The real doctors would have been in charge. She would not have put a convent girl in charge of the Ministry of Health. How much time? With the ministry, where the clock? She would have put real doctors and real specialists in the parallel health system. She would have purchased more ventilators, ensured there was more oxygen, ensured that the borders would not allow illegal immigrants in to bring Brazilian variant. The small and micro businesses would have received their grants. NETCO would have increased their loan facilities. She would not have taken out $23 billion in the heritage and stabilization and only used $425 million for the people. There would have been more accountability across the board. Sports and healthy lifestyle activities would have continued and been managed. We would not have been on lockdown, shutdown, and broke down with a state of emergency. The airports would have been monitored. There would have been antibody antigen testing. And Trinidad and Tobago would have been a bubble. Tobago would have kept separate and would have been in the bubble with Barbados so that we could have had tourism continuing. That, I think, is 2 minutes, but that is what Kamala would have done and lots more. There would have been more school feeding, more hampers, more money spent, more belief, more heart, more soul, more love. And she would not have told you that you're greedy. Good night.
Well, I think we have found the fool. We have found that fool who has now become a super spreader. And when you come to the parliament, the road rights that have accrued to people, you can't pass it by you and your PNM members only. You need a special majority. You need the votes of the opposition.
Right now, from the United National Congress, the first woman Prime Minister, the first woman Attorney General, the first woman to lead a parliamentary political party, the first woman opposition leader, let's welcome Kamala Prasad Bisesa, Senior Counsel.
You will never stop fighting for me, fighting for me.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us again as we in the UNC continue to work for you and continue to fight for you. Daily, we are seeing our country heading down a very dangerous path under Keith Rowley and his government. The Rowley government has no intention of improving your positions because their bread done butter, as we say in Trinidad. Their failed health theme must be replaced. 16 months later, we have 817 deaths, over 30,000 confirmed cases, and it has been more than 14 days since I last called for changes. Do you know in that time 200 people have died in 14 days? June is shaping up to be even deadlier than May. I'm telling you, if it were Gary Griffith and there were so many murders in 14 days, you'd be calling for his neck, calling for his head. But it is this government and their failed health team. Every day we see deaths, we see cases rising, but the same incompetent team of PNM Muppets remain in charge during this pandemic. They spend half of their presentation convincing and praising themselves that they're doing well, as if they themselves are unsure of the job that they are doing. But we all know self-praise is no praise whatsoever. In any other organization, in any other institution, when those in charge fail miserably, they are replaced. Changes are made. But in this PNL land, they are promoted. I call again for the incompetent failed team of the Al Singh and the others to be replaced and held accountable. And you know, we have been calling for a commission of inquiry. The Prime Minister has not responded to the letter that I sent asking for the Commission of Inquiry to examine government's handling of the crisis. Citizens deserve the truth. They deserve transparency. And above all, they deserve justice. Through a Commission of Inquiry, this can happen. No one trusts or believes anything anymore coming from the PNM propaganda with their persons disguised as professionals. Do you know in the United Kingdom, Prime Minister Boris Johnson, he has agreed for a commission of inquiry into the handling of the COVID pandemic there. And if the PNM is always comparing Trinidad and Tobago to others throughout the pandemic, I wonder if they'll follow Prime Minister Boris's lead and open up a commission of inquiry over their handling of COVID. That is one of the only ways that we can find to learn the truth of what has been happening. The only way we can do it, I say, is through a commission of inquiry, an independently appointed commission. And Prime Minister, you tell us, you claim that we are doing reasonably well. But you know, while you're saying that and whilst you're boasting thousands of people, they do not know where the next meal is coming from. There seems to be a great disconnect between the Prime Minister's government and the people of our land. Grave hunger. And then you have your minister watching what happened at South Park recently with people lining up by the hundreds to get a hamper. It is unconscionable that the Minister of Social Development dubbed these people as being greedy. They do not see that people are indeed hungry. They do not see that so much suffering going out there. Their promises now have no weight. They carry nothing. We cannot rely on them. We must never forget that this Prime Minister abandoned the people in their darkest time. The lockdown was about bringing cases down. Yet whilst the cases of COVID have receded a little, they continue to rise. And the mass starvation and suffering has increased. Again, Rowley's attempted to weave the lies of uncertainty as he premised our hopes of vaccines on a continent also facing the same turmoil. It is only a matter of time before he announces that those vaccines will not be obtained. So now it appears all the promises about vaccines, we're not going to get them. But I do want to ask, is it true that this government has ordered 1 million doses of Sinopharm vaccines? You cannot get any others. And so I'm asking you, tell us, have you ordered 1 million doses of Sinopharm? And if that is the case, what is the cost of those vaccines for us? Your mishandling of the pandemic, coupled with the fact that over 100,000 citizens have lost their jobs since 2015, this came out very clearly in the NIB reports. And remember, the NIB reports only tells us about job losses of persons who were registered with the NIS, and therefore that is only a percentage of the job losses across the land. Here we are now, coming today to Parliament, shouting across the floor, thumping your desk that you're coming to give Tobago self-government. Self-government, autonomy, nothing is further from the truth. When this government tells you to stand up, you better start running. And it's the same thing with the Tobago bills being debated in the Parliament today. They come forward with legislation in an attempt to direct the future of Tobago as they see fit. This is not self-government for Tobago. This is going to be cabinet government from a central government, which is the PNM government. The bill being debated will not give Tobago greater autonomy. It will make Tobago more dependent on Trinidad. And by the way, you know, the AG and WPC, the leader of government business, they stand in the Parliament and they don't seem to know the law. They don't seem to know the history, and they repeat the same stories over and over and over again. They have a narrative that is totally false. So, leader of the House, Camille, she tells the House, you know, Tobago was made a ward of Trinidad in 1880, whatever. Tobago was made a ward. That is not true, Camille. And then Farris repeats the lie. It is not true. Tobago was made a ward of Trinidad and Tobago. In the same way, Chaguanas was made a ward of Trinidad and Tobago. In the same way, Arima was made a ward of Trinidad and Tobago. That was our state, Trinidad and Tobago. The two came together in a unitary fashion. And that's when we had a system of wards. You remember, thereafter we had systems of parishes, systems of county councils and so on. Now we have municipal corporations. So that is not true. But I do understand that the people of Tobago want greater autonomy. They want self-government. And Camille Robinson-Reggie today in Parliament is talking about internal self-government, talking about federalism. I think she even knows the difference between the two. How can she talk about internal self-government, autonomy, and the next breath say, well, we don't want federalism. Well, what do you mean? What does each mean? And again, you all are just hypocrites fooling the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Let us remember that it took a UNC government, and before that, it took a UNC NAR government to make major changes to legislation to govern Tobago. The PNM, with all their bleating and crying and crocodile tears about 100 years and 200 years and nothing for Tobago, what did you give Tobago? What did you give them? It took a UNC government in 1996 together with Robinson, Mr. Robinson, late president, may his soul rest in peace, to bring substantial legislative change. Then again in 2013-14, the government I led brought a bill for greater self-governance for Tobago. Okay, it was rejected. But I think I heard one of the Tobago leaders now saying that bill was better than the one that PNM has brought in 2021. Okay, it was rejected then, but we had more many years later. We need to change, we need to take passing times and so on. So here we have a prime minister, out of touch, a Tobago-born boy, as a wee boy, born in Tobago, and seems so out of touch with the people of Tobago. Apart from the two PNM representatives, who obviously will praise this bill, every other Tobago leader has come out against the bills. Every single one, without fail, they have totally rejected these bills. And then you want to come to tell us in the parliament, is the UNC blocking it? You want to tell me today, I heard you again, WPC Camille, saying, is the UNC, never put a UNC candidate in Tobago? What does that mean? What is it? What is it that you're trying to say? And you know why we did not? I'll tell you. But then you had to correct yourself. You came back in your same almost two-hour-long boring speech. You see, oh, I made a mistake, you know. Jaylene John was a UNC candidate some years ago. And Deborah Ramsey was also a UNC candidate. And yes, we have not put any UNC candidates. Why? Why in Tobago? Why? Why? You know why? Because we respect the right of the people of Tobago to determine their political arrangements in Tobago. We respect that right. And therefore, we don't put the UNC candidate there because we want the people of Tobago, as they want, to govern themselves. But what you are doing now, you are a centrist party being run out of Trinidad, and you want to dictate to the people of Tobago. That's your boss, so we always put a candidate. What does it mean? It's a centrist party in Trinidad governing what happens in Tobago. And these bills put a chokehold on the people of Tobago, just as they've been doing for Trinidad. These new bills that they're boasting about, these will put a chokehold and stymie the development of Tobago. Let the people of Tobago determine the manner in which they want to govern themselves. Government does not have the political mandate to speak on behalf of the people of Tobago or even for the majority of the people in Tobago. So you want to stuff this down people's throat. You want to say this is the best thing that has ever happened to Tobago. Shameless crocodile tears, hypocrites. Because you have never in all your 60 plus years, you have never really done anything substantial for the people of Tobago. So why do you bring it now? You think you're fooling people? Why did you bring these bills now in this haste and waste and rush? When the people of Tobago, the leaders of Tobago said, look, just give us 2 more weeks. Give us 2 more weeks. Let me show you the volume of documents. Can we get that report? This is a report they're debating today. Look at the size of this. They said, look, give us 2 weeks more. What would have happened? The sky would have fallen to give the leaders in Tobago 2 weeks more. This is what you came today to debate. Please, look at this. Look at this, okay? 2 weeks. I can't even hold it, it's so big and heavy. They asked for 2 more weeks, what's so wrong with that? And yet that AG comes today and talking about Kamala don't love Tobago. Well, Faris, if you love Tobago, I don't want to see hate. I really don't want to see hate. No love for Tobago, you will not even listen to them. Then you tell the parliament, okay, in the committee stage, let's see what the UNC will say. Will we have amendments? That man now wants me to do his job. You were supposed to bring a bill that would be acceptable to the people of Tobago. No, no, you know what? Committee stage. You know what? It's his main grouse when you listen to him for over 1 hour. His main concern is, listen, he wants the UNC amendments. He wants the UNC to do what is his job. Well, I'm not going to help you. You need to talk to the people of Tobago to determine what the people of Tobago want. If you really love them, listen to them. Why don't you listen? Why don't you talk to the people of Tobago instead of pontificating in the parliament that you know what is best for Tobago? I will tell you, in 1996, UNC then, led by Mr. Pandey, we had a coalition government with Mr. Robinson. We moved to give Tobago greater autonomy. You know what we did then? I was a part of that government in 1996. We put into our constitution something called a Tobago House of Assembly Fund. You know what that was about? To provide revenue, provide monies to fund the running of Tobago. That was placed in the constitution of Trinidad and Tobago by a UNC NAR government. You know now what they've done? These bills they've now brought, these bills remove that fund from being inside the constitution. Removes it, places it under a simple majority bill, which means tomorrow you could come and change it. Tomorrow if you get vexed, like when Dr. Williams became angry with Tobago and they didn't vote for him, what did he do? He abolished the Minister of Tobago Affairs. He did all kinds of things. You put it in a simple majority bill, but today you're boasting about placing in the constitution and making sure they're entrenched, and yet you take out something so important as the funding for Tobago, you have removed that out of the constitution. It is very disingenuous that the PNM has opted to make this major change to our constitution, and they're doing it when? During a state of emergency. Doing it during a state and a lockdown state of emergency. And again, WPC Camille heard her on the Parliament channel today. We put these Tobago bills in restaurants. We put them in the airport. We put them in the seaport. We put them in people's office. And you shut down the whole country. Any restaurant is open. Is the airport open? Again, the hypocrisy where you wanted to prove today how much consultation that you did. You printed all these things and put them in everybody's office when everybody's office is locked down. Locked down. Hypocrisy and crocodile tears, all it is. So here it is, by the stroke of a golden PNM pen, you're removing the THA fund provision from the constitution to put it in a simple majority bill. Today, the main focus of our citizens is survival and economic recovery. And in the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of the lockdown, you bring a major piece of legislation that attempts to seriously alter the constitution of our republic. And you do it in the lockdown without any proper, adequate consultation. So why are you rushing forward with something which will have a lasting, defining effect on our nation? Just days ago, as I told you, citizens lined up for food. And this is the time they are trying to force this bill through the parliament. This government is totally tone deaf. Does anyone remember the PNM's roadmap to recovery? Just before election, big fact document, roadmap to recovery. Where is that? Where is it? Not a single thing out of that roadmap. It was a roadmap to nowhere. Not one thing has been implemented by this government. Thousands jobless. Thousands homeless. And the best they could tell our citizens is, don't worry, you know, we're not as bad as Haiti. We're not as bad as Haiti, where we really reached now. When we were the number one in the Caribbean under this Rowley government, we are now being compared to be a little better than Haiti. Shameless, totally shameless. And Rowley's quickly taken us down the road to Haiti. You know, yesterday I met a Venezuelan woman at my constituency. She told me, Kamala, when I saw those lines by South Park Plaza with hundreds of people waiting for food, I felt I was back in Venezuela. That's where we are going. And only yesterday I was in my constituency again. And they're telling me on the south beaches, Venezuelans by the thousands are lining up to do what? They want to go back. Things so bad, they actually want to go back to Venezuela. Down in south where so many had come in, now they're lining up. They want to get a boat to take them back to Venezuela. They have no plan, this government. They have no vision. You know, I read a saying that went like this. If things remain the way they are, the poor will have nothing left to eat, but the rich will always have. If things remain the way they are in Trinidad and Tobago, the poor will have nothing left to eat, except, you know whom? The PNM and their finances. They are well taken, I say, bread, done, butter. They are taken care of. And now we went to court. A good citizen took the matter, Saddam, where Saddam, MP Saddam helped us, Anna Ram Logan, a team of lawyers, went to court to force Imbert to lay the NIB reports in the parliament. For 2 years, he has been in breach of statutory duty, his duty under the law to lay these reports. And these reports are very, very important reports. Since the last budget, I have been consistently calling on Minister of Finance to present the NIB reports for 2019 and the one for 2020 to Parliament. And he continued to ignore the calls. It was only when he was challenged in court and the court ruled and gave leave for judicial review of his failure and or neglect and or delay in laying his reports, he came the very next day. I mean, how puerile. The next day, 2 years he's holding this thing. And once we went to the court, that's why people, you know, Faris always say, oh, UNC, going to court. Well, some days that's the only thing we can do. We can talk, we can send letters, we can send FIA applications, we can call on government and they will not act until threatened in the courthouse. So when that happened, he brought the reports. And it's his haste to lay these reports. To me, that is an admission that he was guilty of breach of his statutory duty and did not lay the reports as he should have under the law. And in his haste to lay them, one of the reports is incomplete. One of his reports is incomplete, so the court matter will still subsist because you think you get away by running and dropping it, but then it's incomplete. The 2020 report, which will be the last one, is incomplete. It misses, is leaving out all the financials, and these are very important things for the country to know. Because now we are reading you're selling out NIB assets. A story today saying they're going to sell NIB assets. I'm told they were already selling, and nobody knew. Because they've drawn the fund down so badly, the NIB funds, that what they have to pay out exceeds what they are receiving. So your pension's jumping up, your injury benefits, your maternity benefits, all the things that you could get under that NIS scheme from the NIB, all of that is jumping up. And they have given us no plan. How are they going to grow that fund? How will they increase that fund to help citizens? Instead, big story, they're going to sell. You know, selling what that would mean? A big fire sale. You know what's a fire sale? Sell it to your friend and your family at the lowest cost. And again, our citizens will suffer. It is clear to see why the minister would risk bringing his office and gazetted duties into dispute, as the elements contained within the report paint a grave and troubling picture about employment and unemployment and the fate of hundreds of thousands of pensioners. The reports show that about 112,000 persons, I said thousands, about 112,000 persons lost their jobs since 2015 when they came into office as up to June last year. Reports only give us up to June last year, so you know it's going to be more from June last year coming into this year, June again. That's one, and I made the point earlier that the NIB reports do not deal with people who are self-employed. They do not deal with people who are not on the register for NIB and don't pay NIS. So a lot of others, apart from the 112,000 more people, have lost their jobs. We now see some of what they were trying to hide for the past 2 years. The reports clearly highlight that under the Rowley regime, as of June 2020, registered about 113,000 lost jobs since 2015. This is a significant decrease in the number of persons employed and therefore contributing to the fund. At this point, the NIB is insolvent, thanks to Rowley and his government. The NIB fund has been pushed to the point of insolvency because of the decline in contributions from these about 113,000 people. They're not paying NIS contributions, so again, monies have dropped. Over the weekend, we saw the headlines. Soon, as I said, they will sell, but I am told they were already selling. They had already started to sell. So government must be honest. They must tell us if our pensions, the people's pensions, are in jeopardy. It is very worrying, you know, they said they want to raise the pension age from 60 to 65, so they'll save money. What that means, they want to raise it from 60 to 65, so persons will have to work an extra 5 years, and they will have to wait an extra 5 years to do what? To collect pension. To collect their pension, government must come and be upfront and honest with people. And then they must tell us what are their plans to manage this NIB fund efficiently and competently. I'm calling government to tell us whether the hundreds of thousands of persons, pensioners, are in jeopardy after these reports in the NIB, the documents placed in the NIB reports. Tell us if you may go even further and start pushing to 65 retirement age, you may want to go to 70. Because you seem to have no other plan. You have no plan how to grow this fund, how to increase it to take care of our aged pensioners. Throughout his regime, Prime Minister Rowley has been the least transparent of prime ministers with the least transparent government in our history. They demonstrate a clear policy of denying the public vital information on the nature of state agencies, and they're deliberately running from those demanding the truth. And ordinary citizens, as I said, had to go to court to get these reports. These are very difficult times for our country. The scenes outside Park Plaza and many other places point to grave need, not grave greed. I want to thank all our citizens who are extending a helping hand to fellow citizens. Unlike what the PNM has been saying, we don't agree with that because people come to us on a daily basis. It's a disgrace, Donna Cox. As a sister, I am ashamed of your comment. That is a disgraceful comment about greedy people. It's becoming clear that our country is plunging into catastrophe with a completely paralyzed and inept government at our control. Citizens deserve much better than this. And once again, here we are today, big song and dance in the parliament. And you know why that is happening? You know what's going on in this country? Pick up the newspapers and they're moving ahead to sell the refinery. So while people are busy and they come there and they want to speak for 2 hours, can you imagine? Listen to Camille Robinson Regis for 2 hours. During COVID, they shut down all the speaking time. So they want to talk for 2 hours. Farris wants to talk for 90 minutes to say what? To lie, to fool people, to mamagai people, and to betray the people of Tobago. That's what's going on. And whilst everybody on this song and dance, in the newspaper, big thing going on with RFPs for Garakara. I'd spoken about it before. Not many people paid attention. When I raised the issue of conflicts of interest with Scotia Capital, Scotia Capital was used by Inbird for the first set of RFPs, and now they're hiring them again. Conflict of interest, they are the people out now out there sending out RFPs for the sale of the, or lease of this refinery. And then we have Minister Stuart Young, who recused himself for the cabinet, from the cabinet every time a matter relating to Scotia Capital came up. And he's the Minister of Energy. You hire in Scotia Capital, you recuse yourself from the cabinet. Why? Because there's a conflict of interest and you are the Minister of Energy. Well, you better step down and recuse yourself and take yourself away from the Minister of Energy. You cannot be having a conflict of interest with matters before the cabinet and you are the Minister of Energy to oversee, to supervise the sale and or lease of that refinery. So let us not forget. There's a fellow, you may remember him well, very famous singer, Gypsy. And Gypsy used to say that the PNM, he said every time you see PNM pointing finger at your eye, is because they want to dig out your eye, but them doing worse than what they're talking that you're doing. So they dig out everybody's eyes, they point all their fingers, whilst in the same time, they take advantage of people in this country. They take advantage. You take advantage of the poor and needy. You take advantage with Farris recusing himself with all these big rentals, taking advantage of the poor, of the needy, and have your minister saying the people want him as a greedy. That is advantage. This government takes advantage of all the people, vulnerable people in this country, while their friends, their family, and their finances go clear. Listen, Trinidad and Tobago, wake up. Wake up. Now is the time. We must continue to work. We must continue to call on the government, end the lockdown, and let our people go back to work. End the lockdown, let people go out and earn a decent living wage. I thank you very much. God bless, and God bless Trinidad and Tobago. Thank you very much.
I need the kind of love that can outlast the night. Is willing to fight when the going gets tough and my strength's not enough.